Hello everyone and a very warm welcome to this exclusive video interview series brought to you by Oracle in association with People Matters. I'm Yasmin Taj, Senior Editor with People Matters, and I'll be your host for this conversation. Oracle, along with People Matters, is curating a series of video interviews titled The Reboot Toolkit, HR's Guide to Reimagine the Workplace. We all know that the workplace is going to be new for HR too. There's a growing consensus among HR and business leaders that the emerging new workplace will be hybrid in nature. This means companies need to reimagine and redesign their strategies. From recruiting, experience, and skilling, companies will need to rethink workplace practices in a way that enables them to make optimum use of talent with flexibility as a key business value proposition. In order to understand more on this, we have in focus three industries, BFSI, healthcare, and IT/ITES. From which renowned industry leaders of top-notch organizations will share their valuable inputs on various facets of reimagining work. These inputs will be stitched together in the form of a first-of-its-kind video ebook, which is designed to give you a holistic view of the emerging future, technology priorities, and strategic action steps that business and HR leaders need to be thinking about. And today we have with us Birlasoft's Chief People Officer, Arun Dinkar Rao. Arun has over 28 years of experience within the IT/ITES, finance, and internet industries, and is widely regarded for his insights and opinions on bettering the human resources, learning and development, and talent management functions. Arun has managed large-scale operations and is experienced in leading change management initiatives. Thank you so much for joining us, Arun. It's a pleasure to have you here with us.
It's my pleasure, and thanks a lot for the very kind introduction.
Thank you, Arun. And we also have with us Oracle Corporation's Head HCM Application Strategy India, Hardeep Singh. Over the last two decades, he has been an entrepreneur, a student of human resources, and a consultant to many Fortune 500 organizations on areas of talent management, organization design and development, employee experience, leadership development, succession planning, and career management. Thank you, Hardeep, for joining us for this conversation today.
Thank you very much, Yasmin. It's a privilege to be in this conversation with you and Arun. Thank you.
So thank you to the both of you for joining us today. Looking forward to a great conversation ahead. So without further ado, let's begin with the first question. And I'll come to you, Arun, first. The IT/ITES sector had to scale up fast during the pandemic. What, according to you, are going to be the top workplace shifts as we move to a hybrid workplace model?
Yasmin, I think what really mattered was that organizations needed to be thinking on their feet, ensuring that what we had committed to clients doesn't fall through the cracks, and ensuring that our people were safe. So all the strategies that kind of came out and got enacted were a response to these three critical parameters that we needed to take care of. So it was all about enabling a very safe work from home. That was the primary ask at that point of time, and that's what companies did, and we managed to do that as well. More than 98% of people became work from home enabled within 10 days of the onset of this pandemic. So I think that was the biggest. Biggest ask and the biggest deliverable that we managed. Now, as we look forward, I think while this is a new normal, I would assume that we're going to be looking at a distributed workforce model, where organizations and their work practices will need to become more accepting of a distributed workforce. It is not that everybody is going to work from home. So what we are going to see is real estate expansion may not be linear in relation to growth of organizations, and therefore technology and workplace practices would start enabling a distributed workforce model. That's what I believe is in store for all of us.
Thanks for sharing that, Arun. I also agree. I think, yes, the future of work will be a mixture of office goers and work from home people, a distributed workplace. How do you manage them? I'll move on to the next question, and this is for you, Hardeep. So, Hardeep, what, according to you, are the top emerging technology priorities for the future?
Yeah, I'll just take a minute to put some context. One, of course, the pandemic has completely amplified the rate of change. Second, The world is so interconnected, economies are so interconnected. If any regulation or political change, social change happens in any part of the in a remote part of the world, it impacts all of us. And third, of course, technology is uprooting business models and the way we deliver to customer and how way we deliver to customers and the way we solve problems. So in this context, the organizations which are thriving the most are the ones which are truly agile, which can quickly adapt, like what Arun mentioned. It just took them a fraction of a month to really, you know, reorient their entire delivery, reorient their entire working model. So in this context, I would say the three technologies which could really emerge, and the first one is not really a technology, but an architecture, is how we can have the entire HR technology on one stack, right from hiring to retiring, with a little bit of pieces, a little bit of elements, with minimal elements which are bespoke, but you have one architecture which can quickly allow you to make changes and allow you to harness data. The second piece is around artificial intelligence. Now, over the years, what we've seen is that this has become very, very strong, much more mature than it was even something like a year back or maybe 2 years back. Today, in fact, we just conducted a recent survey. 6 months back, we did a survey, and 62% of respondents who are essentially employees at that moment said they're more comfortable, they trust a robot more than a manager. And that was very surprising. And at that moment, we had the hypothesis that maybe it's for transactional tasks. And just a week back, we did another survey globally, 12,000 respondents. And I kid you not, 92% said they would be more comfortable talking about stress to a robot than to a manager. Now that's completely uprooting how employees and how people are relating to technology and to the benefits of it. So that's the second piece on how artificial intelligence will get embedded, how data will get unlocked, how you will not only have hyper-personalization, but you will also have deep and very, very sharp predictive analytics. I think that's something which will come in together in this artificial intelligence piece. The third piece, I would say, is blockchain. It's still nascent. Few organizations are adopting it, but it has tremendous use cases, be it in skills passport, be it by governments adopting it. So we went through report cards, which were manual, and then you have the 10th and the 12th. Imagine if all our scores on blockchain and it's publicly there. So, you know, right from kindergarten information around a person around his or her skills will come onto a blockchain passport, and that has far-reaching application ramifications. Within the organization construct, you could have background verifications, rehiring to offers, all of that pieces blockchain can solve for. So blockchain would help do compliances. Artificial intelligence, in my sense, would solve for hyper-personalization and analytics. And of course, the architecture being the big daddy, which will help it make it seamless and for organizations to quickly adapt to any change which will come.
Hey, thanks, Harvey.
Hey, Asman, I just want to add one point to what Hardeep said. I kind of love that architecture piece that he talked of. I think underlying that from an organization perspective, I think this pandemic has only accelerated the movement and adoption to cloud. So I think more and more organizations will feel more and more confident in terms of moving and housing their applications over the cloud, which probably means that on-prem solutions will slowly kind of take the backseat, which sits in very well with what Hardeep said about that backbone being consistent. And because I think this pandemic has proved that those organizations which had their core applications, significant portions of their core applications or the cloud were able to kind of bounce back faster and were able to kind of face lesser disruption in their own, you know, service to their own client base. I think just wanted to add the cloud adoption piece as something that will see a much, much bigger movement in the coming years. I don't know if Hardeep kind of agrees with what I said, but I
Arun, our marketing team is going to love this. Our business is cloud, so
yeah. Absolutely.
But business aside, I think your point is absolutely valid. The cloud offers minimal disruption as long as the cloud partner is has enough and strong, robust backend processes for business continuity.
Yep.
So I, and that's where the architecture and the single stack comes
yes,
in. So the
data center,
the middleware is there, the application is there. So all of that helps deliver seamless minimal disruption to our customers.
That's true.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Thanks, Arun.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing that, Hardeep. Some really great thoughts on the kind of emerging trends in IT that we're seeing, be it the architecture part, the artificial intelligence part, the blockchain part, some really interesting thoughts there. So I'll come to you now, Arun. So companies need to build synergies with other functions within the organization, like finance and IT, to break information silo. How important is this, and how are you doing it at your organization?
I think more than ever. I think if you look at it, what you just said is a kind of a presumption that successful organizations need to have, which is, you know, seamless flow of information and collaboration in kind of execution. I think the last 9 months has seen breaking down of these silos. I think at least at Birlasoft, the way we have gone ahead, it is no longer about a function, you know, kind of driving something and being totally responsible in the sense no other person being part of it that way responsible. I think we have moved away from that. We realize that there is nothing that can be achieved if people kind of live in their silos and try to execute. I think it is very important for us to realize that any management action kind of impacts across these boundaries, and hence you need to have cross-functional teams. While the lead could be the functional owner, you need to co-opt people from other disciplines, other functions when you are serious about executing a solution. This is also important because the time to market, if you for a minute, you know, you just don't think about go-to-market as in delivering the end thing in the marketplace, but you think of if there was a word for go to market for delivering your own offerings inside the company, I think you are that much faster and that much assured of success if there is involvement of different opinions, views, and stuff like that while you're baking the solution. I think this pandemic has given the fact that the time to resolve has been crazily short in these last 7-8 months, and what came out as a natural response is to involve more people in solutioning, and remember that the lead is always with the functional owner because they bring in the subject matter expertise, accountability lies there. But I think getting these cross functional teams involved has delivered faster, better, and more successful results, and therefore I think this is going to be the way of the future. I think organizations will become more nimble. These boundaries will become permeable. Of course, there will be subject matter expertise that will reside in various, for a minute, for argument's sake, because I don't, let's say pillars, okay, or towers, because that seems to be a more acceptable word than silos in terms of narration. And once again, you know, just pointing back to the enabling technology, so without espousing the cause of a particular, you know, product developer, I think the more you have a seamless flow of information across your technology architecture, the easier it is for you to deliver solutions. So I think organizations have to become mindful to make sure that even if they adopt, let's say, bespoke responses to scenarios, I think the technology architecture should be something that allows flow of information and intelligence fairly seamlessly across the various organizational functions.
Thanks, Arun. I think, yes, I totally agree with you. Organizations need to become nimble. There has to be a free flow of information between, you know, different departments. So thanks for sharing that. Hardeep, how about you? How do you think HR should build the right synergies between the right stakeholders?
In essence and in principle, I would completely agree with Arun. The data, you know, essentially you have people data, you have operations data, and you have financial data. And managers have seen this data in disparate reports so far. But what if a person what if a manager could come in and see the operations data? How is the projects doing? How is the financials moving to it in terms of collections? And how is the people side to it, be it engagements, experience, spirits, leave attendance, sick leave, mood, and if an organization can even go to, you know, today technology allows for you to measure heartbeats, ECG, and if there is consent there, you could pretty much do a stress meter, which is a heartbeat meter, which could be captured from a wearable device, right up to a financial data with middle points of operations and delivery mechanisms thrown in. And what this will do, and this is from a manager's lens, but if I was to break this from a financial manager's sense or from an operations person, what this will do is that they will start seeing data with both eyes. Right now, everyone's looking at data, okay, this is my goal sheet, this is how I'm going to deliver it. But what if we were to present this data to them every day? And what this data will then do is we'll create a platform for dialogue and communication. And that's my sense, that once you have data which is common across different functions, and all functions, and even if you're an HR person, if he or she is seeing the financial data and operations data, all of us together, the conversation, the dialoguing, the collaboration, and subsequently the trust will be much better. And hence the silos will drop. So that's my take on this. Yeah.
Hey, Yasmin, I would like to actually add a couple of follow-on points. And some of the thoughts kind of got evolved as Habib spoke. I think what HR can do was something that I missed out, because I spoke in a more kind of a more generalistic fashion. I think what we as function owners need to do is to find ways and means of driving collaboration as a key fabric of the organizational culture. I think for far too long we have been rewarding individual functions, individual performances. As you move the focus to cross-functional teams, people coming together to solve issues, I think the key tenet then becomes collaboration. I think that's something that we need to think through. Obviously, what cannot get measured will not be delivered. So I think while I speak at a very 30,000 feet level statement of intent kind of stuff, but I think as practitioners, I think over the next several months, probably several years, I do not know at this point of time, I think we need to break down this magic word called collaboration and how we will be able to seed that and make it a part of the DNA. And the second, purely from a technology perspective, I was just playing back in my mind something that I faced the last couple of days. When people take decisions based on present data and past experiences, they often tend to create a situation where we might actually make a fool of ourselves in a future scenario. So therefore, the entire holistic presentation of information with futuristic simulation will help managers make better decisions. And that's only possible when that flow of information becomes seamless and people kind of see more than what they were seeing. And I am of a very firm opinion, though my understanding is still very, very elementary and primitive, I think every manager worth his weight in salt should understand the financials of the organization. You cannot espouse your functional cause without understanding the impact of profitability.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and thanks, Arun, for this. I mean, and as you were saying, I got triggered that, you know, there is this piece around how we create teams. And it's been in my mind for a while that today when we create teams, there's an opportunity for us to make them more multidisciplinary. So if you have operations, finance, sales, all of them together in a team, the chances of marketing, technology, the more multidisciplinary a team is, the chances of us being able to appreciate the other's perspective will be much higher.
Absolutely.
Otherwise, it's us versus you within, and that doesn't help.
That's true.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah, Thank you. It's indeed the era of collaboration and breaking the information silos. So thanks, Arun.
And Yasmin, notice how Arun and me were collaborating.
Absolutely. Yes, totally. That is a great example of collaboration here. So thank you. Arun, I'll come to you again for my next question. So how do you see the landscape of talent changing with the growing scope of combining gig workers, remote workers, and on-site employees?
I think extremely fascinating and extremely challenging. I think for a very long time, we have been talking about the gig economy and open talent network. I remember almost 8 years back when I was part of a Big Four, a group of partners actually started talking about this open talent network and stuff like that. But honestly, as a practitioner, I saw a very limited application of those concepts in organizations. But today, I think this has become real. Partly forced, or probably majorly forced, and people are seeing the way it has evolved. Organizations have become more accepting. Governments have become much more open and liberal in terms of their programs. We leave aside a few geographies which still are under a little bit of I would say undecidedness, if there was a word like that. But I think we are in a situation where we are going to see a very, very high percentage of distributed workforce. And if I may use the word borderlessness, as long as organizations can tap into talent pool, if they can create a secure and safe architecture within which they can deliver programs, I think this entire the experience of the last 6-8 months have opened up a new possibility for organizations, that they will no longer remain constrained to the office locations that they have and trying to attract talent into there. We always had a challenge because we were finding challenges in getting the right kind of talent into the offices. What if you actually moved out the symbolic office to place where the talent was available? And that's the whole thing that's come up. But it's just like there are no free lunches. I think organizations need to understand and appreciate nuances of this globally distributed workforce in terms of being able to spot talent and be sure that from a skill and culture perspective, they will be able to get the right people on board. And second, create that technology backbone which will be safe and secure, so that our clients will not be second guessing these operating models. Ultimately, we owe it to the client who's giving us the business opportunity. We cannot, in our need to expand or in our need to experiment, we cannot put them at risk. And therefore, as this distributed workforce becomes a larger reality in terms of delivering to business, I think organizations will spend more, experiment more, explore more, and try to put together as foolproof a technology backbone as possible to enable this kind of a borderless delivery to business.
Thanks, Arun. I absolutely love the point on being borderless and you know how this entire scenario has increased the entire talent pool for organizations. People can work from anywhere, anytime, any place, and use any device, and technology is enabling people to just come together and collaborate and work. So that's a great, I think that's one of the best opportunities that has come out of this pandemic. So thank you for sharing that. So now we'll move on to our rapid fire questions for both our leaders. And Arun, I'll come to you again first. So as a leader, what is that one top priority or key focus area that you are focusing on right now?
So it's a rapid fire question, but I will take a minute more to answer. I'm trying to create a break free organization. I just made this up as you asked me the question. What do I mean by break free? We deliver to clients exactly the way we were delivering in the past, probably better. So there is no break in our commitments and our delivery to the clients. In terms of our employees, apart from the fact that they don't get to physically participate in day-to-day working, we are trying to create an environment where they feel part of the organization. They get to experience as much that we can make available virtually, as much as is possible. And we deliver the services, every other service that they were availing in office consistently, albeit virtually. So I think purely from being a leader of the organization, I think trying to ensure that break free scheme of things has been my priority. But coming from an HR perspective, I think my biggest priority has been to ensure that people feel safe and feel healthy as they're delivering to business demands, to create the enablers to help sustain the entire spirit, the culture. That's been the focus of the team. But I think as an institutional leader, the aim and the commitment has to be to ensure that break free.
Absolutely. I think I love the point. This is the first time I'm having a break free organization. So thank you. Thanks, Arun. That's going to be a headline for us. So thanks, Adeep. I'll come to you now. As a leader, what is your top priority right now, currently?
The one priority we have is health, be it physical, mental, emotional, financial. The entire spectrum of health is what is the key priority for us right now. And I love what Arun said, you know, being completely on demand, you know, being at a being level, being on demand. So yeah, that was really nice.
Great. Thank you. So the next question again is for you, Arun. What is that one idea on leveraging technology to boost experience that you would like to share?
I'm a big believer in democratization of data. For far too long, we have kept data locked behind cupboard doors, behind lockers. I believe that employees, whether they are the foot soldiers or whether they are managers or they are leaders, they should be able to see, and they should be able to manipulate the data. And manipulate is not in that negative parlance. Whatever they need to play with data, they should have the right, and we should have the checks and balances from a technology perspective. That's been my biggest worry. We all the time we keep complaining about inaccuracy of data. We try to work with 80% right data. I don't think there's anything called 80% right data. Either data is right or data is wrong. And I think organizations need to enable an environment where they have right data. And that's only possible when you democratize data. So that's my biggest thing. The rest of it is all the bells and whistles that will sit on top of this.
Great. Thank you. Democratization of data. I really, really like that point. Hardeep, what about you? What is that one idea on leveraging technology that you would like to share?
Take the employee as a customer and treat him and her as an individual. So that makes the case for solving for employee needs as we would solve for a customer needs.
Absolutely. Great. Thank you. I love that point as well. So on that note, that was all we had time for today. And thank you so much, Arun and Hardeep, for sharing such great insights with us. Some of the things that I really loved today was talking about how we can create a borderless organization, a break-free organization, how the focus is going to be on breaking the information silos, how agility is going to be so important, and employee well-being, obviously, is one of the key points that most organizations are focusing on right now. And between all that, one thing that's most important is how tech will play the role of an enabler here. So thank you so much once again. So ladies and gentlemen, this was Birla Soft, Arun Dinkar Rao, and Oracle Corporation, Hardeep Singh, sharing their insightful thoughts with us. We really hope you enjoyed watching it. We'll be back with our next industry leader in our next episode. Thank you so much once again, Arun and Hardeep. It was a great conversation. See you all in the next episode. Thank you and bye-bye.